It's another edition of Time About the Movies. Today, we're taking a look at the films of March 13th, 1992. We got a lot of movies to look at today, seven of them to be exact, so let's not waste any time. Let's just jump right on into it, and we'll start off with what could arguably be the best movie released this weekend, but this weekend had some pretty good new releases, but this one stood out the most for a couple of reasons, and we'll delve into that once we show you some footage from Joe Pesci and Marissa Tomei in the comedy My Cousin Vinny.
Thing happened to William and Stanley on their way to college.
At what point did you shoot the clerk?
They got framed for murder.
Whoa! Wait a minute!
Now, two kids from New York are in deep trouble.
It's time to make your phone calls.
The clans here, they're inbred, they sleep with their sisters.
In the deep south.
Some of them do.
And only one man can save them.
We need to call an attorney, a great attorney.
He's not your typical hero.
We got an attorney in the family. Great, who?
He's
my cousin Vinny.
You stick out like a sore thumb around here.
Oh, yeah, you blend.
You graduated from law school 6 years ago. What have you been doing since?
Studying for the bar. That's a lot of studying. What's this over here?
You never heard of grits?
Sure. I just actually never seen a grit before.
It's his first case.
Now, didn't I tell you dress appropriately?
You were serious about that?
The way you handled that judge. Oh, you're a smooth talker. You are.
It's their last chance.
The two youths.
Did you say youths?
Yeah, two youths.
What is a ute?
But with Vinny's style.
I wore this ridiculous thing for you.
And Vinny's girlfriend.
We agreed to get married as soon as you won your first case. My biological clock is ticking like this. And the way this case is going, I ain't never getting married.
They're dead meat.
May I have permission to treat Ms. Vito as a hostile witness?
You think I'm hostile? Now wait till you see me tonight.
Joe Pesci is my cousin Vinny.
You two know each other?
Yeah, she's my fiancé.
Well, that certainly explains the hostility.
This is one of those movies where really you don't really need to say a whole lot about it because honestly, My Cousin Vinny's a classic comedy, plain and simple. And it works largely because of the people that are involved in the cast. You have Joe Pesci, who's giving one of his best comedic performances ever in this role. You have a great veteran actor in Fred Gwynn, you also playing the judge, who's also really funny in this, which is actually his last film that he was in before he passed away. Bruce McGill is also in here. You also have Ralph Macchio and Mitchell Whitfield playing the two kids who get arrested and are facing the court. And then there's also Marissa Tomei in a performance that was so good that she won the Academy Award for Best Supporting Actress the following year, which was really rare for the Academy Awards to acknowledge a great comedy like this. Because usually, one of the biggest problems with the Academy Awards, even back then, was that They really didn't put the focus on the comedies and more just the dramas, mostly the Oscar bait dramas. But every once in a while, they acknowledge the comedies that did have some good performances in them. Recent ones have included such films as Melissa McCarthy, who got nominated for Bridesmaids. Trying to think of who else. One of the notable ones, Tootsie, was one of the biggest ones. Honestly, they got a lot of Oscar nominations when that movie came out. Robert Downey Jr., who got nominated for Tropic Thunder, and so many other ones too. But nowadays, that's rare and for them to actually acknowledge that a comedy has an Oscar-worthy performance, let alone one that wins an Academy Award. But really, when you watch the film, Marissa Tomei is really good. She's not only really funny, but she really gives the best performance of the actresses that were nominated that year, honestly. And it's a very funny movie and a pretty straightforward, accurate depiction of how these lawyers do their job. It's an accurate depiction of how the courtroom system works. And that was one of the biggest surprises about it, is how authentic it really felt. It's a really funny film, a really smart film. I really don't have much more to say about this one. My Cousin Vinny, fantastic film. If you haven't seen it already, do yourself a favor and watch it, man. So with that said, let's go ahead and move on to the next movie, which is actually directed by Edward James Olmos, and that is American Me.
We're like two people. One is like a kid. That's the one I cared about. But the other one...
the way it has always been. From father to son.
So we've ever had. It is us.
From brother to brother.
No, move the door, man!
He ruled a world we do not know.
The Italians are still running the show, but they're getting sloppy, man.
You'll regret today you make that choice.
Well, your business kills kids, man.
You know, sometimes your whole life can change from being in the wrong place at the wrong time.
If we show weakness in our homes, everybody's gonna see it.
Our clique, our barrio, our families, that's all we got is it gives to us. It is us. We don't fake it, we just take it.
You got a lot of heart, Carmen. Maybe too much.
From director Edward James Olmos, inspired by a true story, American Me.
You know, I know that music from the Carlito's Way trailer. I'm guessing that this is where that came from, but don't quote me on that. But, yeah, I didn't know Edward James Olmos directed this movie, and he really is a very underrated character actor when you really see the movies that he's been involved in. And this movie in particular shows you kind of why he's such a great actor. This is a really good underrated film. It's a very good underrated crime thriller, loosely based on mob boss Rodolfo Cadena, and... It's just a very good movie. It's visually stunning to look at. The writing overall is very solid. They have a great cast involved in this. It's just a really good underrated film. It's a movie that I don't think a lot of people really talk about when it comes to the great crime thrillers, but it's a pretty damn good movie. It's a really good film that, in a way, could kind of be kind of the Mexican equivalent to The Godfather in some way, shape, or form. Which I know that's high praise. I know that's putting a lot of high praise on this, but. There are definitely a lot of elements here that feel like almost took a lot of inspiration from the Godfather movies, and it definitely shows in this film. As far as I know, I don't think he's ever directed another film after this. If he did, it's probably one that I haven't heard about, but I'll have to look into that. But as far as the first film goes, he does a pretty good job with it. It's a very underrated film. I'd say definitely check it out if you want to see a good underrated crime thriller. American Me is definitely one that you should definitely check out, so... with that said, let's go ahead and move on to the next movie, and that is Article 99, which for some reason has an incredible all-star cast, and yet I've never heard about it, which could mean one of two things, but we'll watch the trailer and then decide on that afterwards.
Sir, without certification, we have no actual proof that you are disabled.
You want proof? All right, I'll give you some damn proof. Is there some proof? Yes, proof. You want some proof? Here's the damn proof. I got the proof. Take the proof right here.
Welcome to Monument Heights Veterans Hospital.
My name is Dr. Peter Morgan. It's my first day here.
Oh! The government's come up with a whole new disease called the creeping cutback. Whatever you need, you ain't gonna get. And whatever you get... ain't worth checking.
We're not responsible for every lunatic out there just because he wants to wear a uniform.
Mayday!
Hey, baby, what's happening?
Now, Rudy!
Look out! Okay, next batter.
What do you use as an anesthetic, the electric chair?
When you're in the ward.
Treatment they authorize he doesn't need. They won't authorize the treatment that he does, so the idea is to keep him here until they finally do.
Let's go!
It's like a war going on in there.
Tell me about it, kid.
I operate this hospital in the best interest of our patients.
This hospital operates with only one interest, your own.
When you're under the knife.
This patient needs open heart surgery. I thought heart surgery was no longer authorized.
Look, we're here, he's here. Why don't we make the most of this?
I need to get rid of certain dysfunctioning elements.
You think the priorities are cutting the budget instead of easing the suffering and the anxiety of the people that this place was built for?
When the heroes are forgotten.
It's like this. I got nobody else to give it to.
Look, everything's gonna be all right.
When the bottom line is life or death.
You better treat him as well as you treat your boss, so help me God, I'll break your neck.
There's one rule
you've got a break.
Article 99?
Article 99.
Article 99.
One choice you've got to make.
That's far enough.
Disarm that man.
Before 25 an hour.
Pull.
So just to run down that cast again, Ray Liotta, Kiefer Sutherland, Forest Whitaker, Leah Thompson, John C. McGinley, John Mahoney, Keith David, Kathy Baker, Eli Wallach, Noble Willingham, Lynn Thigpen, and Jeffrey Tambor are all in that cast. And the music is done by Danny Elfman, and this is directed by Howard Deutsch, who also did comedies like The Great Outdoors and to lesser extent Howard the Duck. But yeah, how come I never heard of this movie? Well, it didn't really make a whole lot of money at the box office, and the critical response to this was very mixed on it. And definitely by that trailer, you can kind of see maybe why this didn't work out so well. I don't think they had a good idea of what kind of a tone they wanted to set with this movie. Did this want to be more of a straightforward comedy? Did it want to be more like a drama? You really can't tell from this one trailer what kind of direction they wanted to go with it. And to me, I think that's the reason why this movie doesn't get talked about a whole lot, and probably why this movie isn't really worth it, despite the great cast that's involved in this. Like, I mean, who knows? Maybe it could be good. I haven't seen it. I can't really comment on it, unfortunately, but that trailer did not really sell me on that film whatsoever, unfortunately. So, that's pretty much all I got to say about Article 99. Let's go ahead and move on to a better movie, at least in terms of it being of noteworthiness, and that is Howard's End. This is, of course, another Merchant Ivory production. It's actually the third adaptation of a novel by Ian Forrester, the other two being A Room with a View and Maurice. And basically, the film explores class relations in terms of the 20th century Britain through events in the life of these sisters. You got a great cast that includes Anthony Hopkins, Vanessa Redgrave, Helena Bonham Carter, and you also have an Oscar-winning performance by Emma Thompson in this film. And you could definitely see why. This is one of the few Merchant Ivory films I've actually seen, and honestly, it is pretty good. It's a movie that really works mostly because of how great the cast is. I think this cast works phenomenally well. You could definitely tell that the effort is there to try to recapture the spirit of this story, and it just works because of how good the cast is. It really does keep the film afloat. Visually, it looks impressive. The storytelling is gripping and groundbreaking. And it is just really a ton of fun to watch. It's a very good film, a very well-made film. It's definitely worth a watch. I don't think I can really say anything more that hasn't already been said already on this one. Howard's End, just a great film. So, and let's go to the complete opposite end of the spectrum with a great film and its own reasons. The dark comedy Shakes the Clown.
Two-fisted action.
I know karate.
Well, I know the Vulcan nerve pinch. High drama.
Hey, wait a minute. You clowns are on dope.
And forbidden romance. You might want to look somewhere else.
What's your name?
Shakes. Shakes the Clown. Oh, my head!
You're not funny, clown.
Okay. Blow that horn one more time. Shove it right up here.
Everybody loves a clown, so why don't I?
Mom, there's a naked clown in our bathroom.
Your total disregard for the clown code of ethics would make your poor father Lippy turn over in his grave. Oh, and Shakes?
Yeah.
Take a bath, will you?
Yeah.
Oh, really scary.
Guys like that, you know? You give clowns a bad name.
When's the last time a film's made you feel this good, huh?
You spit out!
No, I didn't.
I saw you.
No, it was yummy.
Hubba, hubba, Julie Brown.
Leave me alone, milkman scum!
Bobcat Goldflakes, wait.
Here I come! Ready enough!
In the Citizen Kane of alcoholic clown movies.
What a morning.
Shakes the clown.
Had enough?
Yeah, this was definitely a movie that was way ahead of its time. I mean, it got largely panned by critics. It was actually nominated by the Razzies as one of the worst movies of the year, which, considering that it was up in the same category as Nothing But Trouble, needless to say, I think you could tell which movie was the better film, and this movie was that, so. But, this is a pretty damn good movie. It's very funny. It's very much what a good Bobcat Goldthwait film should be like. It's not something like Hot to Trot. It's dark, it's gritty, it's good black comedy. It's friggin' hilarious. I love this movie so much. This is a movie that I discovered as of recently, a couple years ago. I watched it for the first time, and I'm so glad I did, because, man, this made me laugh so hard the first time I saw it. Great movie. Bobcat Goldthwait's great in this. You also have Julie Brown in here. Great cast overall. You got not only them, but you also have Blake Clark, you have Kathy Griffin, Florence Henderson, Tom Kenny, Adam Sandler, even Robin Williams makes a cameo in this movie, and it's just funny. It's just really, really funny stuff. It's absolutely hilarious, and it's a movie that really deserves a lot more attention, and I'm glad that it is getting more of a cult following, because it does really work so well, and It's very funny, but it's also but the way they do the serious stuff, like, they really tackle alcoholism in this and make it work out so make it work so it's not preachy, but it feels very realistic, and that's really one of the great accomplishments about it. It can make you laugh, but it can also make you feel as well. It's a fantastic film. If you haven't seen Shakes the Clown, please by all means check it out. You are doing yourself a huge disservice. If you like good dark comedy, this is gonna fill that quota very nicely. Shakes the Clown, fantastic film, need I say more. With that said, let's go ahead and move on to our next movie that we have here, which I can't really remember it right now until right now, and that is Raise the Red Lantern. So as you can tell, this is a film from Hong Kong, directed by Zhang Zhimou, who also did Judo, which we looked at on a previous episode. He would later go on to do such notable films as Hero, House of Flying Daggers, Coming Home, some more notorious stuff like The Great Wall. But he's got a knack for visually stunning movies. I mean, this movie really looks impressive, and it looks incredibly dark, and it's not afraid to go over the edge if it needs to, but it's a nice-looking film to look at, trailer-wise. I haven't seen the movie itself, unfortunately, so I can't really comment on it, but that trailer does pique my interest a whole lot to see how, like, it looks incredibly dark. It looks incredibly bleak, and my interest is very peaked, so maybe one day I'll definitely check it out. It definitely looks like it could be one of those underrated films that really came out of that time period. Like, I'm not really much into the Hong Kong, into movies, these Hong Kong films as much as everybody else is, but this definitely piques my interest. It's one that I definitely want to check out one day, and I may do that in the near future, so stay tuned for that. But pretty good trailer, though. So, with that said, let's go ahead and move on to the last movie, which... Now, I can't remember that one. Hold on a second. Okay, next, the last movie that we have here is Highway to Hell.
Join us on a dazzling cinematic adventure down the highway to hell. A winding route that stretches from here to eternity. Discover the warm, energetic, inventive, and friendly inhabitants of hell.
Can you tell me the quickest way to hell?
Sex, drugs, rock and roll.
Share with them their traditional crafts and delicious local cuisine.
Vegetarian bitch!
Paging Saddam Hussein!
Bastard!
Down here, that's a compliment.
You'll marvel at the unusual flora and fauna. Delight in the people's daily pursuits.
I'm a lover, not a fighter. Oh.
And see reenactments of rituals that go back hundreds of thousands of years.
Once you have crossed, there is no way back.
I'm gonna scoop your brain!
Learn how a people steeped in tradition have made their city a thriving modern metropolis.
It's the cop from hell!
And meet the individuals who have made hell the international hotspot it is today.
I am the Prince of Princes.
We've heard that story before, haven't we?
Highway to Hell. An unforgettable journey from Sovereign Pictures.
Now we'll have some fun.
So if I was to tell you that this is the same man that directed Drop Dead Fred, would you believe me? Yeah, I didn't think so. This movie kicks the crap out of Drop Dead Fred, but it's really damn good. It's a movie that I don't think a lot of people really mention a lot, but it has to have a cult following, because my God, this movie looks so insane and visually gorgeous in its own way, and it looks like it's a ton of fun. Like, I've seen this movie before. I saw it recently, and it's just hilarious. It's just a fun time all around. You've got this great cast. You have people like Patrick Bergen, Christy Swanson's also in here. You also have Richard Farnsworth. You got a ton of cameos by people like Lita Ford. Gilbert Gottfried as Adolf Hitler. I mean, how can you go wrong with that? And also Ben Stiller's in this movie. And just the visuals in this movie look incredible. Like, a lot of these effects look very practical. And this is actually written by Brian Helgeland, who would later go on to become is a very notable screenwriter. He would write films such as L.A. Confidential, Payback, A Knight's Tale, Mystic River, Bloodwork, Man on Fire, 42. These great, great movies. And this was one of his early film roles. This is actually the third film he wrote. And I think this was his last horror film, because he did A Nightmare on Elm Street 4. Then he did the Robert Englund directed 976 Evil. And now this movie. And as I said before, man, this movie is a ton of fun. Like, I went into this completely unknown about what this movie was going to be like, and man, it really took me by completely by surprise, and it's a great film. If you haven't seen it, if you're looking for a fun, good time B-horror comedy, this is definitely it right here. If you think Drop Dead it's hard to imagine that this same man also did Drop Dead Fred. Like, talk about a step down in quality, but in a way, it's a step up from in quality, because this came out after Drop Dead Fred, even though this was filmed before Drop Dead Fred. Like, it was because Hemdale was in bankruptcy. I think they were in bankruptcy, but they put it on the show for the longest time, and then they released it shortly afterward, and just kind of just dumped it out there. But hey, it's out there, and it's actually pretty damn good. If you haven't seen Highway to Hell, definitely check it out. It's really, really well worth your time. So on that note, we wrap up another edition of Time About the Movies. Next time we meet, we got a good set of movies to talk about next time around, including more than likely one of the best erotic thrillers ever made, Michael Douglas and Sharon Stone and Basic Instinct. That comes out next weekend. We also have Woody Allen's latest film, Shadows and Fog. Another screwball ensemble comedy, Noises Off, which is produced by Steven Spielberg. So, will the third time be the charm? Since we looked at two of them yesterday and they weren't very good, will this one be the one that works? We will find out. But we also have Edward II, or I guess Edward II. I don't know too much about it right now, but I'll delve more into that when I do the research tomorrow. And also American Dream. So five movies to look at next time. Should be another good show to check out. So I hope you will do that. Thank you guys for watching. And as always, if you want to see more videos like this, please hit the playlist on the next page. Check out the previous episode. And I'll see you guys tomorrow for another episode. So thank you for watching. I'll see you guys next time. And until then, take care.